Happy New Year to everyone. It is such a blessing to be able to come from 2021 and to this new year of 2022. It is a blessing. That's something we should rejoice in. I know it doesn't quite seem like it or feel like it sometimes, that because there's so much that has been going on. There's a little coolness. There's a rather somberness sometimes when we look at what's going on around us. But God is good. And I'm just so thankful to be here, to see your smiling faces. I think the last time we saw each other or came together was when we had the Christmas Eve celebration. And at that time, we were just talking about the fact that God, or we're looking at the theme of the turning point, and talked about Jesus as an adolescent and what it meant because of his decision that our very lives, our very existence has been impacted because of what he did. And so when I started to think about us, even as a church in 2022, that we're still a relatively young church. We're still in our adolescent stages. So I'm 15 years old. We're still in the process of trying to determine and decipher what it is and to become who God has called us to be and to determine the path that he has laid for us, not to be like anyone else, but to be who God has called us to be and what that looks like. And when I started to think about that, I started to think about it more just God, how do we, in this new year, how would you have me to help lead your people that they can be the expression of Christ on earth? I ask the question, God, how can we engage the people and so they can utilize their gifts and their talents that could bring glory to your name? I ask God, how do we reach another generation that are not bent on consumerism but are evangelistically having the fervor to go after and to reach out to others? And I was asking God, how do we become a church that invites all people to come together in Christ for your glory? How do you do that in the midst of a cynical world where we see there is cynicism regarding politics, there's a cynicism regarding religion, there's a cynicism regarding education, there's a cynicism as far as whatever it may be in Christ, cynicism about even God and religion? And how do we address all these things in this season? Because, God, you have brought us here for a time such as this. There's a purpose. There's a reason that God allowed us to transition from 2021 until 2022. And it's for us to find that. And as I thought about those things and as I looked out and was praying, the word that kept coming to my mind was this thing of prayer. That every great move, every great incident that took place and for the believer was prefaced, was bathed in prayer. And so what does that look like? And I thought about what it was in the Bible. I like what Apostle Paul talked about in 1 Thessalonians 5 and 16 through 18. When he was talking to the people of Thessalonica, he said, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing, and in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." Again, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus, for you. For you, for you, for me. It is God's will. And I looked at that and I was thinking about what he said, that sandwiched in between this thought of rejoicing always and this expression of giving thanks in everything, he says, pray without ceasing. There is a way, there is a life that God wants us to have, that there is an uninterrupted prayer life, that whatever situation, whatever experience, whatever timetable, that you can have this prayer life that is ongoing, that is uninterrupted, that he wants to have connectivity and constant communion with us. And what does that look like? And as I thought about that, I thought about this prayer and looking at the example that was set for. He said that it's in Christ Jesus. So I want to go to, and I want to draw your attention to the book of Luke, and then also to the book of Matthew, the books of the gospel. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. These are the books of the disciples who talk and saw specifically the Jesus' ministry for the over 3.5 years, and they looked at him and they watched him and they saw what he did. And so in Luke, the 11th chapter, verse 1, we'll go there, and then I'm going to go to Matthew, the 6th chapter, verse 5 through 13. And there you'll find these words. And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And then in Matthew, the 6th chapter, verse 5 through 13, it says, and when you pray, you should not be like the hypocrites. Let me pause for a second right there. It says, when you pray, it's not an option. It is not an advisement. It is not something that is hypothetical. He says, when you pray, it is guaranteed there is going to come a time in your life, in our experiences, in our everyday, that something is going to take place, something is going to impress upon us, something is going to consume us so much so that we feel the need to call out, to cry out to something, to someone who can come into the midst of our experience. There is going to be that incident where there is that loved one, that child, that family member, that job, that finances. For the believer, it is going to come about where you're going to have to call on. He says, when you pray, Jesus talks about this again later on in the chapter. When you pray, you should not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in synagogues and on the corners and on the streets, that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have the reward. But you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, there it is again, do not use vain repetitions as the heathens do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things that you have need before you ask him. And verse 9, in this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Heavenly Father, God, we just pray this morning that, Lord, that you will speak into our hearts, Lord. Help us, Lord, to hear clearly from you. Remove any distractions, O Lord, that would prevent us from hearing what thus saith the Lord. And Father, we just pray right now, Lord, show yourself, reveal, O Lord, and how we can draw ever closer to you, Lord, through your word. For us in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For 3.5 years, we find that the disciples have been spending time with Jesus, and they have been watching him, and they have seen something about his ministry that is impactful to their lives. They have seen him doing something and doing things that were unprecedented, that others have, that they have heard and have seen were not able to do. And they were able to see from him that there was something about his private life that impacted his public life. And by looking at this, they went to him and they asked him specifically about this subject of prayer. They didn't ask him about Lord, teach us to preach. They didn't ask the Lord, teach us to deliver. They didn't ask the Lord, teach us how to call down the angels. And they didn't ask for that. What they asked for was, Lord, teach us to pray. There is something that they saw in Jesus' life that was very impactful to them that caused them to ask. And when you talk about men, it's something that you don't really see men going and asking someone to show them how to do much. We'll figure it out, generally speaking. But they took the time and said, Lord, teach us, show us how we are to pray. And this morning, I want to spend some time talking about what it is that Jesus has done that has impacted the lives of these disciples so much so that they want to learn and model their behavior even after Jesus. There are three things that Jesus demonstrates in those passages that we just read, and from Luke to Matthew and throughout the Gospels. Three, critical components that Jesus has in his life that they see that they want to replicate. One, Jesus demonstrates a model of consistency when it comes to, came to his prayer life. So much so that it impacted these disciples. They wanted to follow his example because they saw what was going on behind closed doors. They saw what was going on in the private life, that it was directly impacting what was going on in his public ministry. Secondly, Jesus prescribed for them the method for creating an atmosphere of prayer. Talked about that again, and when he talks about that, how we ought to pray, and I'm going to talk with you about that in the weeks to come, about how he establishes and prescribes a method, the mechanics, how we approach prayer and developing an atmosphere that's conducive to hearing from God and to talk with him. But then thirdly, he also talks about there is a manner. Jesus said, there's just this manner that I want you to pray in. He provides a template. He provides a way to show us a model, a template, a model of prayer that can be used when it comes to approaching him, when it comes to calling on him. He gives us something to go from in how to draw ever closer to God in creating a lifestyle of prayer. I thought about just simply, what is prayer? And what we find is that when it comes to prayer, there are a lot of theological definitions for prayer. But in simple terms, it's simply our talking with God or communicating with God. And notice what I said there. It's communicating with him. It's talking with God, not our talking to God. Because if we use the phrase of talking to, it suggests that it's a monologue. That there is one person, there is one individual who's doing all the talking, but that's not what God wants when we talk about prayer. He says, I'm talking with you. That means it's dialogical. That means that there's not monologue, it's dialogue. It means that I'm listening to you as you listen to me. I'm talking with you as you talk with me. It's all in how we develop a more intimate relationship with one another. It's the same thing applies when my wife gets at me all the time, but Derek, you need to do a better job of communicating. You need to spend some time talking to me. Talking with me, that is, not talking to me, but talking with me. And the more that we converse, the more that we spend time and talking with one another, the more that I'm able to glean from her and hear her heart, and the more she's able to hear from me, spending that time. Jesus models a prayer life that is so consistent, that is so regular, that is so routine, that is so intimate that it is impacting how everyone else around him views him and sees what takes place in the public. A couple of things that we're looking at here is that there are three fundamental steps that Jesus has prescribed that he shows when it comes to developing a lifestyle of prayer. The first thing is that we should have a certain time that set us apart to pray with God. A number of examples that are given in Scripture. If you look in Mark, chapter 1, verse 35, it says that in the early morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left his house, and went away to a secluded place and was praying there. Said again, in the early morning. He talks about it again in Matthew 14 and 23. He says, and when he has sent this multitudes away, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. Now when evening had come, he was all alone. He was there alone. And then again in Luke 6, verse 12, he says this. It was at this time that he went off to the mountain to pray, and he spent the whole night in prayer with God. Jesus was known for often getting away from the crowds to spend some time with God. And whether it was with a time that he went in the early morning or he went in the midday, he went in the evening, he even spent time at night in order to find some opportunity to commune with God. I know we live in a society that is bent, that is consumed with filling our days and filling our time with things that are going on. But no matter what Jesus did, Jesus took the time Specifically, I'm going to set this time aside that I'm going to get with my Father, that I'm going to converse with him, I'm going to speak with him, I'm going to listen to him. He set that time apart. Now, I don't know about you, but my best time to get with God is early in the morning, before everyone gets up, before all the noise starts, before the kids start coming down clamoring, and before anything starts, I spend that little time with God just to hear from him. But it doesn't have to be that it's just in the morning time. For you, it may be that you're a late owl. It's after everybody gets to bed and you have a little time to think about and to get by yourself. Or whether that may be in the middle of the day when you take a lunch break. It does not matter, but the time, it has to be scheduled. It has to be an appointment. It has to become more intentional. And so we prescribe to them the times that you can look. It does not have to be, it won't always be at the same time. But as long as you set some time apart, have you taken the time to give to God each day, to commune with him? If you hadn't, look at what Jesus does. Again, it's not just in the morning. It doesn't have to always be in the midday. It doesn't always have to be at nighttime. But as long as you set some time apart, specifically to speak with him, God will meet you at that time. Second thing he does, he says you should also have a certain place. In addition to having a certain time that you set apart to talk with God, you should have a place that you have designated, a certain space that is designated that you can get to away from the noise, from all the clamor and everything that's going on, that is specifically designed to hear from him and to speak with God. And so there are a number of examples, again, when it talks about the places that God went and Jesus went and he prayed. It says in Luke 5 and 16 that, but Jesus himself would often slip away to the wilderness and pray. He says again in Luke 22 and 39 through 41, Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. And on reaching that place, he said to them, pray that you will not fall into temptation. He withdrew about a stone's throw away beyond them and knelt down and prayed. And in Matthew 26 and 36, this is what he says, then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to the disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. He designated those places and those spaces that he would go to that were specifically to get away from all the noise. He said he left from his ministry. He left from around the crowds. He went to a place where he could get away from everything and just be in solitude with God. And he said, whether it was in a wilderness, I know for some of you like to get out and you like to run. That may be a place where you find, because the place is not just the physical, it's also in your state of mind as well. A place where you can remove all the clamor, a place where you can find some peace to hear from God, to see the works of his hand, some place. He went to the wilderness. It said he also went to a mountaintop, the Mount of Olives. He got above the fray. He got away from, again, the noise. He got to a place where he could hear God and see God clearly, away from all and everything and everyone else. But it also said he went to a garden called Gethsemane. So wherever the place may be, whether that is in the woods, I remember my wife's grandfather, I think he was like 93 years old when I got a chance to meet him. But he had this little shed out in the back that he would go and sit down on a bucket away from the noise. And I went and had a chance just to sit and to see what he was doing. And he mentioned about praying, just some time just to get away from. We have to find that place, that peace, that solitude. Again, whether it's in your gardens, whether it's running on the track up a mountaintop or riding a bicycle, whatever it may be, find that place that you can commune with God and he will meet you there. Jesus modeled this before his disciples. It wasn't always the same place, but as long as you set apart some place that you can go to commune with him, he will hear. So we have a certain time that he wants for us to set apart with him. We have a place that he wants us to go to in order to commune with him. But he also has one other thing that he describes that are given in those in the passage that we read. He said there needs to be a certain plan. What's your plan when it comes to conversing with God? There are a number of different prayers. Now, I think the elder mentioned this morning. There are hundreds of different prayers that we find in Scripture. Hundreds. And of those hundreds, we find that there are hundreds of those prayers that go answered, that we see that God has responded to the prayers that have been lifted up because those have stopped the moment to get aside from, to get away from, and to call on his name. He responds. And so one of the prayers that I thought about was in the 1980s and 90s, there was this prayer called the Prayer of Jabez that came out, that became very popular. And in the Prayer of Jabez, in 1 Chronicles 4 through 10, it said this, and Jabez called on God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me. People use that model. And it said, and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. So God granted him what he requested. People use this as a model for prayer when it came to talking with God about what was going on in their life. God, help me to broaden, to bridge, to build out even more, that I can reach out and I can show just how awesome, how gracious, how giving, how loving of a God you are. It was just one plan. There are other plans. You'll find also in Psalms 51, David talked about this, what was called the sinner's prayer. I'm not going to read all of that. But it does say that, have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. It was yet another template, another example of how and what prayers can be utilized when it comes to approaching God and speaking with him. But the prayer that I want us to focus on is the prayer that Jesus gave and that was often referred to as the Lord's Prayer in Matthew, the 5th chapter, and looking at verses 9 through 13. It is this prayer that we hear, that even as children, that our parents give us, in addition to some other prayers that we give, and I'll talk about that a little bit later, that he gives this prayer specifically to the disciples to address the question that they ask, Lord, teach us to pray. And Jesus provides this template. He provides this and prescribes this template for us in the manner in which we should approach God, the manner in which we should address and pray to him. There is something significant here because, again, the disciples, they never asked about teaching me how to preach or teach me anything else. This was the one incident, the one occurrence that we find that they inquire of Jesus to teach us about. And it's how to pray. I believe that in this new year, in 2022, that prayer is going to be pivotal. Prayer is going to be, it has to be the foundation of everything that we look at doing in moving forward in this year. And so he shows them that through the Lord's Prayer, how it is that you can draw ever closer, how it is that you can develop a lifestyle of prayer, and how it is that you can become what Isaiah in 56 chapter talked about, a house of prayer. And it's going to be that spirit. It's going to be that mindset. It's going to be that prayer life that you begin doing, dealing with individually, that we'll be able to experience collectively as a body and see God move to where he wants to take us in this new year. And so I'm praying that God show us, because one thing I've seen is that when it comes to the plan, God's plan never fails. When it comes to his plan, because many are the plans of men. We have our own ideas, we have our thoughts, but when we approach and ask God to show us your plan, his plan will succeed. And so I pray and I'm asking, God, show us by this time, in this moment, in this new season, what is the best way that we can move forward is has to be bathed in prayer. And so in the next couple of weeks, I'm going to be going over this a little bit more in detail. This is just an introduction. This is just to get us started, because there is more that he wants to talk with us about and what prayer looks like and how it can be powerful, because Jesus' ministry was powerful. There was no question about it. But just as the disciples realized that there was something about your prayer life that's going to impact your personal, that's going to impact your public life as well. And if we're called to go out and we're called to be a light unto a darkness on a sitting on a hill, that means that we're going to have to go back to the foundation. We have to go back to this prayer, this pivotal point, in order to move forward and to do all that God has called us to do. And so I pray that you will pray with me. I pray that you will be inclined all the more to seek, to ask, to inquire, to spend that time. Those three things. Find that specific time. Find the time. Make it a point. Don't let it happen by chance, but be intentional. Find that place where you can go to and you can hear from him clearly, removing the clutter of your mind, removing all the distractions, that you can hear him more clearly. And also look at his prayer that he has given to us to model, not just for us to repeat it, but to dig into it and to find out even more of what the riches are in this prayer that he wants for us to get for ourselves and for our hearts and for our lives. And so I pray with you. And so, I know that prayer is not going to always look the same. It's not. Because there will be those moments when you will bring in worship. There'll be those times you bring in quiet reflection. It'll look a little different. But there are certain ingredients that should always be there when it comes to drawing closer and to praying with God. And so, on next week, we're going to pick up part two, talking about, Lord, teach us to pray. And I pray that you'll invite someone else to talk about this as well. Begin right now, going home, and let's start developing. Let's start thinking about being intentional about how we're praying, what we're praying for. This is a new season. This is a new beginning. This is a new day. And I believe God has it started with prayer. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the word, O Lord God, that you've given us in your Holy Word. We thank you, Father God, for how you've modeled the lifestyle of prayer before us as believers, and that, Father God, that you have, through your consistency, Lord God, you have demonstrated, Father God, that through your personal prayer life, Lord, that it will impact us publicly and how we are to communicate, how we are to engage with others. We pray, Father God, that you will help us, Lord God, to not only just be to see your model, but Father God, look at the methods that you used and to explore the mechanics of prayer, to dive in even more, Father God, to know you. So, Father God, we pray this morning that you will keep us, Lord, that you will continue to be with us, Lord God. Help us, Lord, to know you as the one true living God, and speak to us, O Lord God, right here. Remove the clutter, remove the anxieties, and Lord, let us be one with you as you are one with the Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.